So far in this course, what we have looked at is the structure of the material, and then we said the structure is not going to be perfect, and hence there are going to be some defects. So defects are part and parcel of the material system, and once you have defects, and you then after studying about defects, we have discussed different kinds of defects, such as point defects, line defects, area defects, and so on. And then the implication of these defects on the deformation behavior of the material, right? We have looked at how does plastic deformation happen in single crystal material and polycrystalline materials, and so on. Okay? And then we have looked at the key mechanical properties that are required to describe the deformation behavior. So the key mechanical properties that we have looked at are the elastic stiffness in the elastic regime, and then we have looked at something called yield strength of the material and ultimate tensile strength of the material, and so on, right? And we have also discussed how do we go about measuring these mechanical properties. So once you know the mechanical, so these mechanical properties that we have measured are the result of the microscopic or microstructural events that are happening. For instance, if you would measure the yield strength of the material, that actually represents the onset of plastic deformation, which is nothing but the dislocation motion, right? So that is something that we are seeing is as yield strength of the material. And the hardening part, where we have looked at the hardening response represented in true stress, true strain terms as a power law, and it need not be power law, but we assume a power law hardening is one kind of an hardening, right? That is basically representing the microstructural events such as dislocations interacting with themselves, or dislocations interacting with some point defects, or dislocations interacting with grain boundaries, so that the dislocation motion is impeded within the crystal, and that's what results in something called hardening, right? And then eventually the material loses its capacity to hold the load or resist the load, and hence you will have local necking happening, and so on, right? And the material eventually fails. So if you know the mechanical properties, then you can now go about designing structures or components such that the stresses induced into the components as a result of the external load that you are applying are below the critical values. For instance, if you are looking, if you are interested in designing a component which should not break ultimately, then you know what is the ultimate strength of the material, that is where the breakage happens, and then you can ensure that the stresses induced in the material are well within that value, right? So by knowing this mechanical property, you can go about designing the material. And if you are interested in limiting your deformation to the structure only within the elastic limit, that means you don't want any permanent deformation, right? Then you should ensure that you know the yield strength of the material, because that is where the permanent deformation starts setting in, and then you design your structure such that the stresses induced are below the yield strength of the material. That's when you will not impart plastic deformation, right? And that is the reason why we have studied about mechanical properties. And then once knowing this, then we should now be able to discuss various modes of failure, and if at all there is going to be a failure of any kind, we should be able to assess a component subjected to some external loading, whether it is going to resist deformation or not, or whether it's going to withstand the loads that we have applied, and so on. That is something that we need to do as a mechanical engineer. And in this module, we are actually going to talk about precisely that aspect. And the first module we are going to focus on static failure. When I say static failure, the load that you are applying to the material is not changing as a function of time. As if you apply a load at time t equal to 0, you come after 2 years, it's still time the same load. The time as a function of time, your load is not evolving, right? If it is evolving as a function of time, then you say it's a dynamic loading, and hence you cannot possibly use the same set of failure theory, failure phenomena that we are talking about. We will say what do we mean by failure theory in a moment, but here the first module we will be focusing on static failure theories. Okay? All right, this is the content. So first we will spend some time understanding the stress tensor, and then we will talk about a very important concept called invariant. What do we mean by an invariant of a stress tensor? And then we will talk about various failure theories, static failure theories like ductile materials, what are the failure theories that one needs to use for brittle materials and so on. And then we define a quantity called factor of safety. And all these things we will do without assuming any sort of stress risers. But what happens when you have a stress riser? For instance, if you take a plate and you apply a load, the plate will have certain load carrying capacity based on its yield strength. Now, you introduce a notch or a hole into the plate. Will the plate be able to resist the same load when it was doing fine when it did not have a hole? Okay? So, what is the effect of the stress concentration or stress concentration at notches? And then you will talk about application of failure theories to various design problems. We will actually do a bit of design. So the philosophy of design will become clear to us in this course, and when you go to design of machine elements, you should already know what do we mean by design. Okay? So the first module will be focusing on understanding the concept of stress tensor, and then we should be able to write invariants of a stress tensor. And then we will try to deduce a relation between eigenvalues of a stress tensor and principal stresses. And we will talk about the stress concentration factors for specific types of loading and geometry. And we will discuss various failure theories, both for static failure theories primarily, both for ductile as well as brittle materials. We will argue why they require different set of failure theories. And then we'll talk about the derived expressions for von Mises. This is one of the important failure theories, Tresca. These two are the important failure theories. Does not mean that other failure theories are not important. You should also know what they are. But these, we will discuss more details about these failure theories for ductile materials. And then you should be able to design simple machine elements like bar, shaft, beam, and so on under different loading conditions using different failure theories. And we should be able to, in the end, once we have understood the failure theories, we should be able to discuss the relevant merits and demerits of each of the theory. So which theory has to be used for doing actual design of the machine component. Okay? So before we go about prescribing a theory for failure, we should know what do we mean by failure, right? So what do I mean by failure may not be failure to you, right? Isn't it? So we all should have a common definition for failure, and only then, when we define a failure theory, every one of us will be on the same page. So in that context, we should be able to understand what do we mean by failure. So does failure mean the ultimate fracture, the breakage of the component? Is that how we should define failure of a material? Or how does one define failure for if the material is ductile and if the material is brittle? The definition of failure in these two materials, should it be the same or it should be different? So for several engineering applications, what can be considered as failure? And our material properties, which we have discussed in the previous module, are they important to define a theory for failure? Okay? So for instance, if you, all of you are using bicycles, right? So on the bicycle, you have the bell, right? So you have a lever which you press and then the bell rings. And let's assume that the bell lever was bent. For some reason, one of your friends was not happy with you, and he or she, while walking alongside your bicycle, bent the lever. Okay? Then, does your bell stop working, or you can still use it? You can still use it, right? But it may not be convenient ergonomically, because you may not be able to press the bell with the same ease, or probably you need to put in a little bit more effort. But the function is still guaranteed, and hence you will not throw away, right? But if the lever, so let us say I am drawing the top view, and let us say this is your lever, right? Something like that. And you will be pressing here. What if this lever is bent this way? Then if you have to press the bell, you have to do this or do that. While cycling, it is not that easy, right? So then you probably want to change your bell, right? So what do you mean by failure? So you will change only when it failed, right? Failed in doing what? Failed in meeting its intended functionality. The moment any machine component fails to fulfill its intended functionality, that is when you can call this guy as failed, right? So for many machine components in mechanical engineering that we use, the intended functionality may not be lost completely, maybe it is lost partially, right? Even if it is lost partially, then you are actually losing some. For instance, if you are having your bicycle, and the bicycle over the time, what happens to the length of your chain? What happens to the length of the chain? All of you are using bicycles, right? All of you know what do I mean by chain. Yes or no? Yes. What happens over the time? The chain length increases or decreases?
Increases.
Very good. So when it increases beyond certain limit, what happens? It keeps coming off, and once in a while you have to get off and then put on the chain again, right? Which is something that you don't like, right? So that is caused due to the permanent deformation that you are importing to that is imported to the cycle chain. So you don't want to have this permanent deformation. The moment you have a permanent deformation, it is actually not serving the purpose the way that it should serve. You should not expect your cycle chain to come off every now and then you go and put it back. That is not how you expect your cycle to work, right? So when there is a permanent deformation, several of the machine components, for instance, if you take bearings, shafts, for instance, if you have a shaft put on between two bearings, supported between two bearings, and it is transmitting power. So what happens if your shaft has a permanent deformation? It bends like this a little bit. So it is supposed to be straight like that, but after some work, after some service, it actually deformed like this. Okay? So this is the deformed configuration. Then you have imported some permanent deformation. As a result, you will have more extraneous vibrations during the operation of this shaft, which is not called for. We don't want such extraneous vibrations, because what will they do? They will actually affect your bearings. And also, so for instance, this shaft will have a gear, let us say, and this is transmitting torque to another shaft over here. So because of the fact that this is vibrating, this guy starts vibrating, right? So just because of the permanent deformation, although you are not completely getting rid of the functionality, but you are introducing some unwanted scenarios, and also you are losing on efficiency, right? And hence, when you are dealing with ductile materials, you are bound to see this permanent deformation. and the moment there is some permanent deformation, then your functionality is compromised. And eventually what happens after permanent deformation, after plastic deformation sets in, over the time it will fail. If it is a ductile material, because it has to go from yield strength to ultimate strength, it has a lot of deformation that it can accommodate, and eventually it will fail, right? So, in order to avoid any casualty, the way that you typically design any component with a ductile material is that the moment the ductile material reaches the plastic deformation, the moment there is some permanent deformation sets in, that is when you say that the material is failed. Although material is intact, but it is only failed in terms of delivering the functionality for which it is designed for. Right? So when you are dealing with ductile materials, whenever we are saying failure, failure means reaching the stress state, reaching the yield strength of the material. That is what we mean by failure. Whereas for brittle materials, it is extremely difficult to identify something called yielding, right? For brittle materials, they fail by breakage, because there is no plastic deformation whatsoever you can observe. There may be a little bit, but it is extremely difficult to observe the plastic deformation. And hence, brittle materials do not show a clear yield strength, and usually they break due to fracture. And hence, whenever you are designing a brittle material, you have to design for the ultimate strength. So the failure, when you are looking at a ductile material and a brittle material, the definition of failure itself is different, right? That is important to realize. All right. So for instance, you take this two examples. So here this is an oil tanker which has fractured in a brittle manner. It has broken into pieces. And here it's a beam. This is one beam, this is another beam, and this is a column. The beam has buckled and has reached permanent deformation. So buckling is also another mode of failure, and however we are not going to discuss buckling in this class, but that is another mode of failure. So we should also design our structures against buckling, right? So here if you see, the material is ductile to begin with, the ship structure is ductile to begin with, but because of the operational reasons why it broke that way, I am not going to discuss with you now, but there were situations where these oil tankers were broken into two pieces. You have seen, how many of you have seen Titanic movie? So you have seen this guy breaking into pieces, right? But that was a different reason, but this oil tanker has broken into pieces because of something called ductile brittle transition that we will talk about when we are going to discuss fatigue failure of materials. So there are different kinds of failure, permanent complete fracture or plastic deformation, okay? So why do parts fail? People did not know until they started asking this question. So the fact that people started asking this question led to lot of interesting observations, a lot of insight into the mechanical behavior of materials. And that is probably the single most important question that contributed to a lot of scientific understanding of mechanical behavior of materials. And there is a lot of money there, right? So all the time, what do engineers do? They try to prevent failure by designing structures. And when failure happens, you do some postmortem and then see why did the failure happen. In any case, you should know the reason for failure, and several times the reasons for failure can come from completely unknown territories, which we probably did not think that it actually could lead to failure in materials. Okay? We will see such examples during the course of this module. Then we will understand why we need to take into consideration of various aspects when you are designing a component. So this is a Mohr circle for uniaxial tension, right? Uniaxial tension has, it's a two sigma 1, only one principal stress, other two principal stresses are 0. That is why uniaxial tension Mohr circle looks like that. And this circle clearly gives us an understanding that although you are applying uniaxial tension, there are planes in the material, all these planes, which are experiencing shear stress. The applied stress is only uniaxial, normal stress. But there are planes in the material which are experiencing shear stress. And that is the key. And we know, when we are talking about plastic deformation happens due to slip under shear stress, right? That's what we have discussed. So, if at all you are going to talk about plastic deformation, you have to talk about the shear. So, unless there is shear, you cannot cause plastic deformation, because shear is what causes slip, right? So, although you are applying uniaxial tension, you see that there are planes which are subjected to shear. And this is for pure shear. And when you are applying torsion to a shaft, then when you are doing torsion, you know that you can calculate the principal stresses, and you will come up with, this is the condition for pure shear, right? Here sigma 1, sigma 3, and sigma 1 is equal to negative of sigma 3, right? Suppose if you have hydrostatic state of stress, you know, what do I mean by hydrostatic state of stress? Yes or no? Huh? Yes. Sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3, either compression or tension, does not matter. That is equal to sigma 1 equal to sigma 2 equal to sigma 3. What is the radius of Mohr circle in terms of your principal stresses? You see here, you will figure out. Sigma 1, what is the radius of Mohr circle? Sigma 1 minus sigma 3 by 2. I am saying sigma, usually when we are writing in 2D, you will have two principal stresses, and I am representing them as sigma 1 and sigma 3. Sigma 1 is the maximum principal stress, sigma 3 is the minimum principal stress. You could also use sigma 2, doesn't matter. So now, if you have hydrostatic loading, then what happens? What happens to the radius? What happens to the radius? Sigma 1 equal to sigma 3, right? So radius is 0. So how does your Mohr circle look like? It's a point. On which axis? On where? Point. It can be a point, I agree, but where? What is the x-axis for Mohr circle? Sigma? Normal stress. What is the y-axis for your Mohr circle? Shear stress. Very good. Now, for a hydrostatic state of stress, you said the Mohr circle will be a point. Very good. Where is that point going to be? On sigma axis. So, if you draw your sigma and tau, we said sigma 1 equal to sigma 2 equal to sigma 3. So, let us say that is this value. So, that will be your, let us say this is sigma 1. That is your Mohr circle, the point. So, is there any plane on which there is shear here? No. Keep that in mind. That's an important observation to make. When you have hydrostatic state of stress, there is no plane that experiences shear. Yeah? All right. So, in a static tensile test, in general, ductile materials are limited by their shear strength, because shear strength is what is causing yielding, and brittle materials are limited by their normal strength, because the fracture happens due to normal strength. So, the same kind of failure theory cannot be applied to both the materials, because both of them are failing due to two different phenomena, right? So, different failure theories for two classes, like ductile and brittle materials. But before actually talking about a failure theory, so a proper definition of failure itself is very important, right? So as we have discussed, what do you mean by failure? So first you need to know, what do we mean by a ductile material? When you want to qualify something as a ductile material, you need to say whether, what you should look at the percentage elongation, if the percentage elongation up to fracture is greater than 5%, then that is a ductile material. If it is less than that, it's a ballpark number, okay? So don't tell me tomorrow if you find a material which is designed as ductile material whose percentage elongation is about 4.8. So it's not a number that is cast in stone, it's an approximate number. Around that value you will call something as a ductile material, okay? So as I already mentioned, a component may be considered failed if it yields and deforms sufficiently large, leading to improper functioning. So all that is important is that it should lead to a problem in delivering what it is designed for. And a component also might fail by fracture. Both are failures, but the mechanisms are different, as we have discussed. And in addition, the loading can be static or dynamic. So in this first module, we are going to focus on only static. Dynamic loading scenarios we will see in the second module. So how ductile materials fail? They fail by fracture if you load them beyond ultimate tensile strength. Until then they don't fracture. But typically the machine components made of ductile materials are considered to be failed when they yield. So for when designing the ductile materials, you really don't worry about the ultimate failure, fracture, but you are only focused on whether they are yielding or not. So when you are designing materials, you should design against yielding, not wait until it goes to the ultimate strength. So yield strength of a ductile material is much less than the ultimate strength, isn't it? For a brittle material, it is almost the same, but ductile material yield strength is much lower. And that is the number that you need to take when you are designing a ductile material. It's a very important thing to realize.